Before we get into the details of each theories of failure, we'll first discuss about the basic idea behind all these theories of failure. Now, in general, there may be a body subjected to some loads, or we can take simple a beam or a bar which is subjected to load. So the loads, so what are the loads that we can have? So the loads can be, first is force, second can be a moment, and third can be a torque. So this force is measured in newtons, and this moment is measured in newton meter, and the torque is also measured in newton meter. So you are applying force, or you are applying bending moment, you are applying torque. So when you apply all these things, the resulting values will be your stresses. For a simple beam, we will write the formulas. For example, if you are applying only force, you will get sigma x is equal to Fya. So this is varied. If the force is acting along x-axis, then you will get sigma x as Fya. So if the force is acting along y-axis, you will get sigma y is equal to Fya. Similarly, we will find sigma z is equal to Fya, depending on in which direction this is acting. So the applied force will produce normal stresses given by this formula. Similarly, if the moment is applied, so by knowing moment, the moment will also generate what is known as normal stress. Say for a beam, we can write a formula like this, My by I. So depending on in which direction the moment is applied, you may get sigma x, sigma y, and sigma z. If it is each moment will produce a particular normal stress, and whether it is sigma x or sigma y or sigma z, is determined by the direction of applied moment. And third possibility is you can apply a torque, and the torque will produce a shear stresses given by the formula tau is equal to torque into distance from the axis, and then IP, polar moment of inertia. So depending on the direction, the shear stress may be tau xy, tau yz, or tau zx. So it may so happen in some bodies you might have applied normal stress as well as bending stress as well as you might have applied force, moment, or torque. So each one will produce its own stresses. For example, you applied force and moment, let us say. So this sigma x and this sigma x may actually add if they are in the same direction, or they may subtract depending on their direction. Suppose if they are in opposite direction, they will subtract. And finally, when all these things are done, you are left with totally six components, that is sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, tau xy, tau yz, and tau zx. So if some of the forces are zero, or some moment is not applied, or torque is not applied, some of these components may become zero. Okay, but in general, these are known as applied stress. So from applied loads, we got what is known as applied stresses. These are called applied stresses. Once we know the applied stresses, from these we have to find out principal stresses. So next step is to find out principal stresses. These principal stresses, the formula to be used is, if it is 3D, okay, if this is the most general case, then you have to use the formula sigma q minus I1 sigma square plus I2 sigma minus I3 is equal to 0. We have seen what is this I1, I2, and I3 are. These are nothing but invariants given by the formulas we discussed already. So this is more general case. So when you solve this equation, because this is a cubic equation, you get three values. And those values are known as sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. So which one will be maximum? We cannot predict it. So only after we substitute the value, you may get the maximum. Okay. So thus we got three principal stresses from the applied stresses. If it is 2D, it's relatively simpler. So the formula is, you don't have to use this cubic equation. You can use the most famous formula, that is sigma A comma B, or sometimes they may write sigma 1 comma 2 also. So you will use sigma X plus sigma Y by 2 plus or minus root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 square plus tau square xy. So you get two, when you substitute in this, you will get two values, that is first value sigma 1 or sigma a, second value is sigma b or sigma 2. And we know, because it's 2D case, third component sigma s is always 0. So here also we have three stresses. Only thing is, one component is 0 and other two are found out from a relatively simple formula. So whether you use 3D or 2D, you will get in resultant three principal stresses. Now from principal stresses, it is possible to find out principal strains also. In some theories, you may have to use principal strains. So principal strains can be obtained from principal stresses using what is known as Hooke's law or generalized Hooke's law. So using Hooke's law, you can convert all these stresses to corresponding strains, say epsilon 1, epsilon 2 and epsilon 3. These are principal strains. Now with the knowledge of principal stress and principal strain, then we'll go to the theories of failure. So what these theories of failure ask us to do is, so one theory may say you just have to find out normal principal stress. Okay, so let us take the case of first one is MNS, maximum normal stress theory. According to this theory, you just have to measure sigma 1, that is maximum value of the principal stress, and compare this with the corresponding maximum value at the time of failure. So when at the time of failure, in a simple tensor test, you measure what was the maximum normal stress that material could sustain, and that value, so that limit, if you can measure, and if you compare with this limit, and your maximum normal stress at any point is more than the sigma limit observed in the tensor test, then the component has failed. So maximum normal stress theory says the parameter to be measured is sigma 1. So instead, if you go to maximum normal strain theory, it says no, you don't have to worry about sigma 1, you just have to worry about epsilon 1. So this guy says, so you just measure epsilon 1 and compare with the corresponding value at the time of failure in a simple tensor test. So epsilon 1 limit, that will give you the So if you go to say maximum shear stress theory known as MSS. So this theory says only sigma 1 or epsilon 1 is not enough, you just have to take the two values. So this guy says you take sigma 1, you take sigma 3 and take the difference and find out what is known as maximum shear stress. So he'll say you find out maximum shear stress and compare this maximum shear stress with the maximum shear stress observed at the time of UTM test or simple tensor test. Okay, so if that is crossing, that is at any point in your load and in your body, maximum shear stress is crossing the one observed at the time of failure, then the component has failed. So this is the way to measure. And for example, if you go to distortion energy theory, that guy says okay, you just have to consider all the three components. So he says you just have to take a sigma 1 minus sigma 2 summation square by 2 and take the root. So some set of average, this is known as von Mises stress, some set of average. So you measure von Mises stress, and the von Mises stress at any point should be compared with the von Mises stress at the time of failure in a tensile test. So if that von Mises at the given condition is more than the one observed at the time of failure in a tensile test, then component has failed. So it's something like if you want to measure the diabetes in a person, okay, so what by measuring the height of a person, so you'll not be able to find out whether the person is diabetic or not. Or by measuring the blood pressure, you'll not be able to tell whether that person is diabetic or not. So the correct parameter to measure is blood sugar. So by measuring blood sugar, you'll be able to say whether the person is diabetic or not. So similarly, each of these theories says, so there are so many parameters for a body subjected to load. Among these, some guy says you take sigma 1, some guy says you take epsilon 1, somebody says you take the average of this. So basic idea in all these theories is they suggest some parameter. So they say you have to measure this parameter and this parameter at any point is equal to the or more than the parameter observed at the time of failure in a simple tensor test, then component has failed. So that's a basic idea. To summarize, you know the loads are given, applied loads are given, then from the loads you can find out applied stresses. Okay, from the applied stress it is possible to find out the principal stresses, from the principal stress it is possible to find the principal strains, from principal strains or principal stress you can find out these parameters as suggested by the theories of failure, and based on this parameter you can say whether a component has failed or not. Sometimes directly you may be knowing the applied stress. Okay, if this stage itself is known, then you don't have to worry about calculating the stresses. Directly it is given in the problem, so you just have to use these values and directly find out the principal stresses. Or in some other problems you may actually have you may be given with the sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3 directly. So in that case you just have to use the theories of failure directly to predict whether the component is going to fail or not. So this is the overall idea behind this theories of failure.